This is the story of a lost neighborhood and of its people who did not want to go.
I don't want no money. I want my home. The old man is old. See how the old man is old? No more. That's enough. I don't want to get out. I said to my two daughters, they don't want to get out because they spend a lot of money. Plenty of money they spend in this place. We not get nice to nobody. Never.
Hi, welcome to the West End Video Newsletter. Tonight's show, we're going to be talking about the cultures and of the North End, West End, and East Boston. I have with me as my guest John Cristoforo. John is he writes for the Post Gazette and the Suburban. He does some stuff for the Suburban. What was that? The
Suburban Shopper.
Shopper, yeah. And was it you? He writes sort of in an Italian venue, you know, like
it's an Italian twist on everything.
Right,
I do.
Exactly. And it's, you know. And basically, the neighborhoods we grew up in, the North End, West End, and East
Boston.
Used
to be Italian.
Yeah, they were largely Italian at that particular time, in the 40s and 50s. So, and he writes, the Post-Gazette is a primarily Italian paper, too. He writes for Italian, it's sort of, well, it's not an Italian paper in the sense, but it's culturally Italian,
yeah.
I would think.
Yeah. It's Italian-American. It was Italian.
At one time, yeah.
At one time. And I think in the 50s... they started writing everything in English.
Mm-hmm. And you also teach. You teach at BU and Cambridge College.
Cambridge College.
Right.
Yeah. So I spent many years teaching shop in the Boston schools.
Is that right? Well,
yeah.
What discipline? I mean, what trade?
It wasn't a trade. It was an industrial arts area. For many years, I taught drafting, engineering design for college-bound students who wanted to go into engineering.
Mm-hmm.
And then, in their infinite wisdom, they started eliminating the shops, just like they did with arts and music.
Okay.
And I bounced around a bit. I started at Hyde Park High School, and I wound up at Boston Tech for a bunch of years. Then a friend opened a program in Boston called the Barron Center. We got the kids they caught with weapons or were involved in violence in the schools.
Okay.
I had my doctorate by that time, and we were doing psychological assessments and evaluations.
Mm-hmm.
And when that got too stressful, I got out of that, went back into shop, and spent the last 5 or 6 years teaching woodworking at the McCormick School.
Yeah. When I was going to school, I went to Boston Trade, and mechanical drawing was a large part of their courses.
Right.
You had to have, like, I think it was 8 hours a week of mechanical drawing. And, you know, if you were in all these shop classes, not just, I was an automobilist, but if you were carpentry, anything, everybody had to have at least 8 hours in your school week. You had 1 week school, 1 week whatever. And mechanical drawing was a big part of that. It's very important.
We had when it was at Hyde Park High, we had a vocational shop. It was a machine shop, and there was a drafting program that accompanied that, and they were training kids to go into the machine industries that existed in those days. That was not my area. My area was the industrial arts, which took the college-bound students, and we taught them
a little
more of the mathematical end as well as the practical end of drafting.
It was a little different in those days. Everything was a little different. The neighborhoods were different.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't have the same kind of neighborhoods. People like to call their neighborhoods now, but in most cases, they're a little more than people saying hi to each other and maybe once in a while get together for a political meeting or something. In the old days, neighborhoods where you sat out in the street and your neighbors, you knew everybody in town. If you were from the North End, you knew just about everybody that lived there. If you were from the West End, you knew just about everybody that lived there. East Boston, maybe not, because East Boston was a lot bigger.
East Boston was a lot bigger, and it was also more multi-ethnic.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone
That's
thought
true.
It was all Italian. It wasn't.
No, large Irish population.
Large Irish population. When my father grew up there, he grew up in a Jewish neighborhood. Chelsea Street, right out of Maverick Square.
Right. Yeah,
and they were
sense.
One of the few Italian families that lived there.
Yeah.
And I often wondered why my father spoke a little Yiddish. And it was because of the people in the neighborhood.
Of course, in the West End, you know, when I say largely, when I'm talking about largely Italian, like even the West End, everybody, used to say that the West End was, you know, Italian neighborhood. It really wasn't. It was maybe 45% Italian, and probably all the rest mixed Irish. We had everything. There was 24 different ethnic and racial groups that were residing in the West End at that time, which was one of the few. The only other place that had that many was the New York streets. It's funny because they tore both those areas down from the Domain and the Marine. But the West End was like, matter of fact, even South Boston. If you go into South Boston, there's a Lithuanian community. There was a little bit of an Italian community in South Boston. So a lot of these communities.
Also an Albanian community in South Boston too.
Right, and we had a large part of it. Matter of fact, Pier 4, Anthony Athanas.
Anthony Athanas.
He lived on Poplar Street in the West End.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah, it's funny because when I started the newsletter, the West Ender, I started finding out a lot of people that I never knew, right, that were West Enders, turned out to be, like Peter Lucas, who lived in the same building as Anthony Athanas. He used to write for the Boston Herald.
Right.
In those days, neighborhoods were neighborhoods because you got out in the street and you sat there and you talked to people and everybody came by.
You mentioned sitting out in the steps. Yeah. A summer's vacation was sitting on somebody else's steps in those days.
You're right. Or you went to camp. You went, a lot of these settlement houses, there was another thing. Yeah, you know, a lot of these neighborhoods had settlement houses.
I never did that. I was very lucky. My father was a musician. And during the summer, he worked for band leaders who played the county fairs through the Northeast.
Yeah.
And I was an only child, and he would take my mother and me along with him. So, and I got myself jobs as a scenery man on the stages of these county fairs. They all had shows at night. And I did either that or I got a job in selling novelties through the concessions that were in the fairgrounds. So I was 10, 11 years old. I was earning my keep.
That's right. There was a lot of people I knew that used to go out on those counties, used to man the boots and everything. You know, all those boots. There was a lot of West Enders that used to do that in the summertime, too. And but, you know, like I say, those are all neighborhoods. And we used to play sports. The sports were a big part of the neighborhood, too, most of the times. So I remember when they tore the West End down, I ended up down the North End playing for the Christie Club for about 5 or 6 years. I ended up spending about 10 years down the North End after that.
Well, I never played hockey. I was too short for basketball. We couldn't afford football equipment. So one was left, baseball.
The North End had a fairly good baseball team at one time, if I remember right. They used to play Park League baseball.
Yeah.
And they had a pretty good league. I know I used to go down when I started hanging out down there. Some of the guys I knew used to play for the team, and they'd go, and I'd go watch them. But I was basically a football player. I used to play a lot of football. Of course, down the North End, when, you know, in the North End field, if you're playing football, you bounce off somebody and you hit a sewer. it was funny. There was rocks all over the place, but that's fine. Kids were a lot hardier in those days, you know. Parents didn't have time to put you on a leash and take you to all that stuff, you know. It just wasn't that way, you know.
I remember parents coming home at the end of the day around 6 o'clock with the lunch pails and bent over from fatigue. They didn't have time to play with the kids.
That's right.
And as soon as they get in the house, they'd wash up, and the mother would stick her head out the window and scream the kid's name, get in here, it's time to eat.
Yeah.
Get home! Get home.
Or go out and get me a quart of milk!
Yeah.
I remember I got in trouble once. My mother sent me out for a quart of milk, right? And the fire engine's coming. There was a fire, and I went to watch the fire, right? I come back till an hour later, right? Oh, what a beating I took. And the milk was starting to leak, too.
My father had a bad habit of giving me money to get him a pack of cigarettes while I was listening to the 15-minute radio shows in the afternoom, like Superman or Tom Mix.
So
I'd have to go flying out of the door during the commercial and hope I get back in time.
Yeah. Most people don't remember that. In the radios, there were 15 minutes, and there was The Shadow and all those different shows. And then later at night, they had half-hour shows, but there was like Baby Snooks and all those.
Matter of fact, there'll be... when I leave here tonight, I'm teaching a class at Cambridge College in the visual and performing arts. And the area we're on right now is the entertainment industry in America, how it evolved and how it developed, going from vaudeville to radio and then to film and then television.
I assume it must have started originally like on those paddle boats and everything. I mean, there must have been...
Coming up the Mississippi.
Right, because they started...
And minstrel shows, too.
Minstrel shows, yeah.
The two areas that were more equitable, and they really weren't up until probably World War II, were sports and entertainment.
Mm-hmm.
Because they judged you more on talent than they did on anything else, but it was still segregated.
Well, they used to have the black baseball leagues and all that.
Yeah. One of my sons, as a matter of fact, has the shirts from all those teams.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good.
He's a baseball player.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, younger son.
Where does he play?
He's at Lynn University right now. Mm-hmm. They tried to draft him for the Pirates a couple of years ago, but he said he wanted to finish school.
School and do whatever,
So he's studying performing arts, and he's an infielder, and hopefully he'll wind up playing pro ball.
Hopefully. I wish he does.
He's good. He's very good.
And performing arts, if you hit, you know, that's nothing like it.
Been there.
Yeah, you know what I mean? But, you know, on the other hand, like when you grow up in places like the West End and North End, what happens is that you get locked into these things and you go into factories and everything. You spend the rest of your life into factories. There really is no future. I mean, there's a future in the sense that you have your family and everything, and it's great, you know, family life.
I saw this happening to most of the guys I grew up with, or kids I grew up with at the time. We all hung around street corners because that was what you did for protection.
Right.
And for a company. They were like an extended family. And I saw a lot of the kids quit school, go to work, make them 40, 50 bucks a week. Mm-hmm. And the day I got out of high school, one of my close friends called me and said, I got us a job in construction. We start tomorrow. You're going to be driving a bulldozer. I'm going to be driving a tractor. And he's going on and on. We got to the construction site. He was handed a pick. I was handed a shovel. I got home at the end of the day. My hands were covered with blood blisters, and my father and my grandfather started soaking them in salt water. And I looked up at my father and I said, you're right, I'm going to college.
Yeah.
The first generation that came over here, most of them were peasants from southern Italy. And anyone that was educated or was nobility, those were the enemies.
They were the other side,
So whatever they did, you did the exact opposite. That's so rather than emphasizing education, you emphasized a hard day's work.
Mm-hmm.
This is why most of our ancestors came here as laborers or craftsmen.
And the family was a really big thing among Italians, family. And some other groups too, but I can't speak for them, okay, but you know, the Italians...
I see a lot of similarities with some of the, especially the Hispanic groups that have come in since World War II, and especially since the 60s, in that, in education, you see the kids coming into the schools, but going back to our point in time, we went through three generations of trying to make it. I was the third.
Yeah.
My grandparents came here in the late 1800s. And my mother's brothers, there was no aspect of education beyond high school.
Right.
You learned how to read and write, count, then you went to work.
They were lucky you got through high school.
Yeah. My mother was not allowed to finish high school. She had to quit.
Or a woman, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that was a no-no. Would make her crazy if she, you know...
On the other hand, the Jewish families always pushed education.
Yeah.
That's the one thing they did.
They had a tremendous respect for it,
mm-hmm.
whereas Italians didn't, because the people that controlled Italy through the centuries before the unification were all foreigners, and they all had prejudices and were discriminated against Southern Italians. And
that's
most of us are descendants.
Southern Italians are Sicilians.
As you can tell by my sweet looks. I'm
trying to help Tony DiMarco, developer, a book about his experience.
Yeah, Tony was a welterweight champ of the world in the mid-50s, and I've known Tony.
Right.
He didn't remember me from when I was a kid, but I used to hang in a coffee shop on Fleet Street across where he grew up.
Yeah.
But he was a lot older than I, and the kids I chummed around with, and he didn't remember us. But recently, within, let's say, the past 5 or 6 years, I've gotten to know him socially because I belong to some Italian organizations.
Yeah, he doesn't belong so long.
He decided to put his autobiography together, and he enlisted the aid of someone who, I guess, backed off at a point in time.
Mm-hmm.
And Tony was upset about it.
Mm-hmm.
It was recommended that he get in touch with me. And I've been actually ghosting the book farm. He gave me the stories and I wrote them.
Yeah, you put them into a cohesive...
Yeah, I put them in a chronological order, right. Cohesive, let's say, setting, so right. it's understandable.
Right.
Tony isn't a writer, but he's got a wealth of stories that...
Oh, he's got a great history, yeah.
Yeah.
And not just boxing.
No, no. His life, he's done it all.
Yeah.
And he's had a lot of... heartbreak it is.
He said heartbreak, and he's, you know, he said, you know, both. He said he hit the top, and he's hit the bottom,
yeah.
I guess.
Not and I have a lot of respect for the man, and yeah. Matter of fact, I met with him earlier today. We're doing some touch-up on the pages, just yeah. trying to make sure that there are no errors,
yeah.
and it's ready to go go into print as soon as the publisher says okay.
I know I'm going to enjoy reading it. I'll definitely get it and read it. He's like I say, he's a very interesting man. He's a nice guy too, you know. He's some of those fights. He showed some of those pictures with him in Basilio.
Oh God! You know, in those days they'd fight every other week.
Yeah, and they
it's
fought.
Not like today. You fight twice a year.
Yeah. Well, once a year, even, yeah. yeah. And he has a picture of him getting hit by Basilio, right? And his face just going, oh, I said, oh, that must have hurt.
And I've downloaded. The chronological history of his ring events.
Right.
And I was looking at some of the dates. They were weeks apart.
Yeah.
He'd
yeah.
have, in 2 months, he'd have 10 fights.
Well, you know, early in your career, you have to, yeah. because it's, you fight in those days, they have club fights, you know? You used yeah. to fight in the club fights and everything. That doesn't happen anymore.
No, but. No, it's that's part of the past.
Yeah.
Luckily, when I met Pamela Donnarumma is the publisher right. and editor of the right. Post-Gazette, which is the newspaper that I write for.
Yeah.
And luckily, when I met her, she left it to me to come up with an idea.
Mm-hmm.
I was writing at the time for The Interlude, which is a publication of the Musicians Union.
Right.
It's a monthly magazine, and I wrote an article, or excuse me, a column in that called A La Breve, which is short and sweet, but it was yeah. a commentary on who's playing where and mm-hmm. you know, some of the old-time musicians. Because I grew up in the industry, my mother's brothers were all musicians, and my father was a musician. Anyway, I ran into Pam and, at a cocktail party. We were introduced. Mm-hmm. And we got to talking, and she asked if I'd be interested in writing for the paper. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know what I was going to do. And I said, you know, I write about the entertainment world, but mm-hmm. it has nothing to do with what your audience, your reading audience, might be looking for.
Sure.
So then I thought of all the stories that I remembered from when I was a kid, my mm-hmm. grandparents' generation, my folks' generation, and I came up with the title of a column, Nana and Baba Nonno.
Right.
Nana was what we call my grandmother, and Baba Nonno was what my grandfather insisted we call him. It's mm-hmm. a very archaic term.
Right.
Translated, it means grandpappy. And this is what we call them.
Yeah.
And you know, the trials and tribulations of trying to make it in America.
Yeah.
Sometimes they're comical, sometimes they're, you know, very yeah. hostile environment.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
This was their generation.
Yeah, well, it's good to see. Yeah, well, you know, we have the West End Museum, too. So, yeah. Matter of fact, Monica Collins, who writes for the Globe magazine, she's doing an article on the West End, and she came down to look at the museum, and she was... you know, she said, what do you consider? I said, well, I consider myself a historian because, you know, a couple more years, there's going to be nobody around to tell all this stuff. And if the story's not here and the pictures aren't here and everything, especially like if we weren't there with the West Ender, a lot of those pictures and everything would have been buried already.
Yeah.
People would have just dumped them out into the garbage.
Well, as long
the
as
kids.
There's people like you and the former inhabitants of the West End
mm-hmm.
that attempt to keep it alive, it'll mm-hmm. live on.
Well,
something only dies when you let it die.
That's right.
It if you have an interest and you are motivated enough to present that interest to the public, and you do it in an interesting way,
mm-hmm.
they'll pay attention.
Well, the West End is an interesting case because it was one of the earliest urban renewal eminent domain things, and
yeah.
They did such a tremendous job at moving the people and everything. I was at a seminar, and Chester Hartman, who was, he's in Washington now, he's head of a nonprofit called Race and Poverty. And in the seminar, he said the city was extremely proud that they took the West End in a third of the time they thought it would take, and at a third of the cost that they thought it would take. So you know what that means? We all got shut out. I mean, they took us over the hurdles. They didn't care about what the people was going to happen to the people, you know?
Yeah.
So, unfortunately, it's also considered, we have people from a lot of different disciplines, psychological aspects. There was a psychological impact study done on the West End. Sociology and historians. So we get students coming in every year from all different disciplines, looking at how the West End was and how the people were and what they do, and they ask you questions. Matter of fact, we had oral history tapings. We did oral history tapings, and they were up in the West End Branch Library, and part of the question was about kids' games. We have a history of, what people, from errors, we used to play errors, to, a whole host of games, that, street games that we'd ask people questions.
I mentioned that just recently for the umpteenth time in one of my columns, where we used to play steps with a rubber ball bouncing them off.
That's what
steps.
We called errors, yeah.
Half ball.
Well, half ball, we never played half ball. We always used a full pimple ball, whereas a lot of people in other areas cut the pimple ball in half.
We used to cut it in
half. Yeah, we used to use the full one. And punch ball, we played a lot of punch ball. Yeah. I don't know if that was all that prevalent in other areas, but in the West End,
we didn't play that much of it in East Boston, because I basically spent my formative years in East Boston. We moved a long way. I lived on Utah Street in East Boston, and during World War II, all my uncles were in the service, and my grandfather decided to sell the house.
Yeah.
So we moved far away. We were living at 70 Utah, and we moved to 74.
That's right. I was just my sister, when she got married, she married an East Boston guy, who, by the way, was a trumpet player in East Boston, Magliano, Nick Magliano.
What name did he go by, though?
No, he was a good trumpet player, and he could have went with the Vaughn Monroe's band.
I still occasionally play, but nobody wants to see a fat old man on stage.
Well, can you sing?
No.
They'll let you sing. Well, what's his name? Even Tony Bennett came back,
I saw an Ovation, which is a cable station similar to Arts and Entertainment.
Yeah.
They had a thing on him the other night with the Ralph Sharon Trio.
Yeah.
And he made a comeback that was phenomenal.
Yeah, he was...
New generation discovered him.
Matter of fact, Frank Privatira.
Yeah.
And Frank had him...
I was there.
Frank got him.
At his 25th anniversary,
And he was not a big name at that time. No. The next year, right?
He skyrocketed.
Warm, gone, right? And his voice was still good. Right? I was there too, right? And his voice was really, really great.
Speaking of Frank, I think it was his daughter's wedding.
Just recently.
When Al Martino walked on the stage.
Yeah.
And I said, oh my God, it's Godfather 1 all over again. And then just recently, a mutual friend had Al Martino and his wife to dinner.
Yeah.
He was doing something locally.
Yeah.
And I get invited to the dinner party, and he's staring at me, he's looking at me, and I'm looking at him kind of smirking.
Yeah.
I said, you don't remember me. I said, I met you in Albert Ruddy's office. Albert Ruddy was the man that produced Godfather 1.
Yeah.
He had just gotten the part of Johnny Fontaine. And I was knocking on doors in Hollywood at the time, and I auditioned for the part of Sonny, and I met Al Martino in Albert Ruddy's office. Yeah. Unfortunately, I didn't get the part.
Well,
James Caan beat me out.
The first one was a great movie. The second one I wasn't too crazy about, the Nevada part. And I think in part of that was because I could relate to the rest of it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? The tenements and, the culture. Even the wise guys. Now, when you were living in a neighborhood like the North End, the West End, they were wise guys, but you really didn't get a lot of trouble from them unless you created trouble with
them. If you were looking for trouble, you'd find it.
Right.
If you weren't looking for trouble, they were the safest neighborhoods to live in.
That's right.
Because everyone watched out for each other.
Yeah, and the wise guys wouldn't just go out and beat you up because unless you did something to them that, was considered,
I have a cute one for you. I used to hang out in a corner, Brooks and Bennington Street in East Boston back in the 50s.
Yeah.
And there was a floating crap game that started one weekend on a Friday night. By Sunday morning, it was in someone's backyard.
Yeah.
Now, right around the corner from that intersection is the Sacred Heart Church.
Okay.
And all of us in that area belong to that parish. Well, one of the priests got wind of the floating crap game. Left the church, and he's holding his cassock so he doesn't step on it.
Yeah.
He came around the corner, and there are two gentlemen standing in front of the alleyway like this, each one of them twice my size. The priest just pushed them aside, walked into the alley, got to the area where the
cash was,
grabbed a handful and said, "Gentlemen, this is for the poor box." Right. And he walked out. Nobody moved a muscle.
There was a lot of those dice games. We're coming close to the end of the show now. John, would you like to say anything?
No. First, I'd like to thank you for inviting me today.
Always a pleasure.
It's been a long road. At one point, I decided to cross the bridge into the American world.
And, right.
I've come back to my roots over the years, but I felt very comfortable crossing over. I got myself, fortunately, a decent education.
Right.
And I think that's the key to success in this country, learning English correctly, speaking it, reading and writing it correctly.
Mm-hmm.
And I pass this on to my students constantly, especially those that are from ethnic backgrounds where it might not matter in their neighborhoods or within the families.
Well, what happens is, like we're talking about the wise guys, and a lot of times in people in my neighborhood, like you see the doctor walk by and you go, "Ah, look at him, he's right," and then you see the bookie, right? Oh, you know what I mean? And so it was a little different. And if you didn't get by that, you could get yourself in real trouble.
Yeah.
And it was...
you had to look beyond.
And
it,
you seem to have done quite well for yourself.
Well,
matter of fact, you have a nice column, right? Everybody should read it. You should pick up the Post-Gazette. And
you hear that, folks? You have to read the Post-Gazette.
Read the Post-Gazette and read John's column. I mean, that's... It's a nice column. Even if you're not Italian, it'll still work.
I have a lot of readers that are not Italian, right, but they identify with it because of the family aspect of
right.
it. And we're not the only ones that are very family-oriented. There
are
a lot
not.
Of ethnic
course
groups
not.
That are.
Not. I don't mean to imply that, but that's you're right.
I lost my double parking space in the north end. I can't even double
right?
park anymore.
Well,
I had a spot down there, and the old-timer that owned it passed away. So
I don't know what Menino's doing now. He's
got my parking space probably.
A lot of the people, you know, when he was talking about that Dunkin' Donuts down there, he says, "Well, you people got to get over there, you know, and double parking and all that
yeah.
stuff, you know. What are you going to do? I don't know."
I've got to get in touch with them. When the book comes out, Tony's book
yeah.
on his history of, in the ring, I want to set up, see if I can block off a few blocks or a block on Hanover Street right near Fleet Street, which is
yeah,
also
Fleet
called
Street,
Tony DeMarco
yeah,
Way.
Yeah, Fleet Street.
Set up a desk there and just have him signing
yeah.
Books. So.
Yeah. Tony's good. Tony's a real good guy. I had him on the show once. Matter of fact,
I want to see if I get Menino to do this. Don't tell anybody.
Well, I don't get along all that well with Menino. We had some, you know, when we were fighting for the West End apartments, we had some unpleasantries, but... And it wasn't me, it was some of the people I was with, but he sort of like put us all into the same box, you know.
Yeah.
And it's...
I've always had a fairly decent relationship with him because having taught in the city of Boston, he signed the check, so...
Well, we've got Flynn, we Matt Flynn on the show about 10 times. Flynn was the greatest guy for us ever.
Ray Flynn?
Oh, Ray Flynn
yeah.
was the greatest guy. Really, really good for us anyway.
Yeah.
And anyways, we're coming to the end of the show, and... see you at the next. Thank you for coming. And,
it's been my pleasure.
And see you at the next West End Video Newsletter.
Sounds good to me.
out of sight, out of mind.
This is the story of a lost neighborhood and of its people who did not want to go.
I don't want no money. I want my home. The old man is old. See how the old man is old? No more. That's enough. I don't want to get out. I sent my two daughters. They don't want to get out too, because they spend a lot of money. Plenty of money they spend in this place. We not get nice to nobody. Never.
Hi, welcome to the West End Video Newsletter. Tonight we have with us Santo Aurelio. Santo has been here before, and he wrote a book called How to Say It and Write It Correctly Now. He has since updated it by 43%, and it's, I forgot how many pages you have enlarged.
428, Jim.
428 pages. So Santo is a former West Ender, and what happens is you sit around, you start talking to everybody, and you start reminiscing about the old days.